Welcome back to my second lecture on electrostatic. In today's lecture, I am going to talk about the gradient of a scalar function, the geometrical interpretation of it, the divergence of a vector, and the geometrical interpretation of it. Okay. Now, in my last lecture, I had a talk about the ordinary derivative, in which I have explained to you that suppose we are having a function of one variable, say f of x, then what does the derivative df by dx tell us? Okay, and I have explained to you that if you talk about the derivative shows us that how the function f of x varies when we change the argument x by a tiny amount dx. Okay, so in other words, we can also say that, okay, if we change x by a very small amount dx, then f will change by a amount df. Okay, so what we can say, the derivative is the proportionality factor. Okay, now when we had a talk about the geometrical interpretation, we said that the derivative df by dx is the slope of the graph of f versus x. Okay, the same thing we had talked in three dimension as well. Okay, when we talk about three dimension, okay, we have infinite number of direction. So in three dimension, what we have to do is this: we have to take care of direction also. Okay, and it can be represented by three variables, x, y, comma z in Cartesian system, r theta comma phi in spherical system, r theta comma z in cylindrical system. So in three dimension, if you talk about, then the derivative of the function will be represented as delta f. Here this delta, that is inverted triangle which we are having, that is pronounced as nebula, and this delta is given by I car del del x plus j car del del y plus k car del del z. Okay, now what we are going to talk about today is what is called as the gradient of a scalar function. Now suppose we say that we have a function of three variables. Okay, see, we are having a function of three variables. Say I'm taking the example of a temperature, and I'm saying temperature is a function of x, y, z, okay, in a room. Clear? Now, what we want to do is this: we want to generalize the notion of derivative to functions like t, which depend not on one, but it is depending upon three variables, x, y, z. Okay? Now, I had mentioned you that if you talk about derivative does what actually? It tells us how fast the function varies, okay, if we move a little distance. But what happened here? Here the situation is complicated. Why? Because it depends on direction as well. Here what is happening, because I said that it is a function of three variables, x, y, z, so it is depending upon the direction as well. Okay, so as a result of this, what happens, the situation becomes a little complicated here. Okay, suppose you say that we are going straight up, then what will happen? The temperature will probably increase fairly rapidly. Okay, but if we move horizontally, okay, if you say that we are moving horizontally, it may not change much at all. Okay, now in fact the question itself, that you know, how fast does temperature vary, it has infinite number of answer, one for each direction we might choose to explore. Okay, so how to come out of this? A theorem on partial derivative, if you talk about it, tells us that this dt can be written as del t del x dx plus del t del y dy plus del t del z dz. Okay, now if I consider the dot product, I want to write down this expression, okay, as a dot product. So what can I do? I can write this equation as I car del t del x plus j car del t del y plus k car del t del z dot I dx plus j dy plus k dz, and the first term of the bracket can be replaced by lambda times t dot dr, where here this dr gives you I car dx plus j car dy plus k car dz is the displacement in the three dimension. And this delta t which I have written, this delta t gives us the gradient of the temperature. Now, gradient of the temperature. Delta T gives us what? The gradient of the temperature. Now here, this instead of T, we may have any other scalar function. Okay, I may have delta V. Okay, that means this, I'm talking about gradient of potential. Potential is a scalar quantity. So I may talk about the things in this way. Clear? So delta T dot dr. Okay. So actually this delta which I said, no, this is what actually, this delta is I d dx plus j d dy plus k d dz. Okay. So what does this tell us? This delta t, what does it tell us? It tells us how my t is changing when we alter all the three variables x, y, z by the tiny amount dx, dy, dz. Okay, so this is what we have seen about what is called as the gradient of a scalar function. Okay, I'm again repeating my statement that this t may vary, t may be some other function. Okay, del itself is a differential operator. Okay, and this del del x, del del y, del del z, these are the three components of the differential operator, which themselves are differential operator. Okay. Another thing you should keep it in mind is that these differential operator which I have talked about, okay, like del del x I car, del del y j car, del del z del del z k car, these differential operators have no value at any given point in space, but they will give you value only when they are operated on some scalar or a vector. Okay, now this is very important thing. This differential operator which I have talked about, this nabla, okay, this nabla which I had a talk with, about which I had a talk, this nabla is a differential operator. This nabla will not have any value at any given point in space, but only if I operate this nabla on any function. The function may be a scalar, the function may be a vector. Then only we have to differentiate that scalar or the vector with respect to x, y, and z, and we are going to get a value for it. Okay, so this is very important to be remembered, because in MCQ, if you talk about MCQs and all, if you want to ask you a question, the question may be like this, that does the differential operator delta have any value? So you'll have to say, no, it does not have any value. But when it is operated on any scalar or vector, then you are going to get a value for it. Okay. Now, this delta t, if you talk about, this is called gradient of a scalar function. But the gradient of a scalar function will always give you a vector. Why it will give you a vector? Because dot product, it's a dot product. I've changed it into dot product of two vectors. So dot product of two vectors is always a scalar. So this delta t, okay, the gradient of a scalar quantity will always give you a vector quantity. Okay, for example, if you people remember when we had a talk about electric field, I can write electric field as the negative gradient of potential. Means E can be written as delta V minus delta V. Now V is a potential, is a scalar function, but when we talk about E, the electric field is what? It is a vector quantity. So what is the conclusion of it? From there, what can we conclude? We can conclude that the gradient of a scalar function is always a vector quantity. Okay. Now let us move on to the geometrical interpretation of the gradient. Okay, now as seen in my previous slide, this dt can be written as delta t dot dr. Okay, now here one thing you should remember, I have not given here any arrow above this delta, but this delta del operator is a vector, okay? So this should be a vector quantity. This is a vector quantity. So this dt can be written as delta t dot dr. Okay, now if I want to write it magnitude wise, okay, so what can I write? I can write it as delta t dr cos of theta. But what is this theta? Theta is the angle between delta t and dr. Okay, so now suppose you say that we are fixing the magnitude of dr, okay, and search around in various direction. Okay, what do I mean by saying that? That is what we are doing. Actually, we are varying theta, means we are keeping dr fixed. Because suppose you say you want to find out the angle between two vectors, then one of the vector must remain fixed. You must keep one of the vector fixed, and the other vector you must go on moving, right? Then only you are going to get different angles. So here what we are saying is this: we are fixing this dr, okay, and we are searching around in various direction, okay, because t is dependent upon x, y, and z. So it is depending upon direction. So and we search around in various direction, that is we vary theta, okay. Then what do we find? Maximum change in t which we are having. This maximum change in t, it eventually occurs when my theta is equal to zero. What do I mean by saying that? Okay, when I say maximum change in t eventually occurs when theta is equal to zero, meaning of this is that this delta t and the direction dr, the position vector, they are in parallel with each other. Okay, so what we can say that for a fixed distance dr, dt is greatest when one moves in the same direction as vt. Because if you say that, you know, I'm talking, if someone is moving in the same direction as vt, then what will happen? The angle between them is theta. So what we are going to get? We are going to get the maximum value. Okay, so dt by dr maximum is nothing but it is equal to delta t itself, because cos theta, the value of theta is 0 and cos 0 is 1. Okay, so what will be dt by dr? Okay, this is equal to vt. So thus I can say that the gradient of a scalar function is a vector quantity that points in the direction of maximum increase of the function. Now in which direction the function is increasing? Okay, so it will depends on what? Okay, it will point in which direction? It will point in the direction of maximum increase of the function, and the magnitude of that is going to give you the slope along this maximal direction. Okay, so I can say that the gradient delta t, which I have talked about, the gradient delta t points in the direction of maximum increase of the function t. Okay, and as I have mentioned, the magnitude delta t gives what? The slope, that is the rate of increase along the maximal direction. Okay, now suppose suppose we say that we are imagining that we are standing on a hillside, okay, and we are looking all around and find the direction of the steepest ascent. Okay, steepest ascent means that is the direction of the gradient. Now what do? You measure the slope in that direction. If you measure the slope, that is going to give you the magnitude of the gradient. Okay, now here what is our function? Like in this example, when I said about that we are standing on a hillside and we are looking all around us and we find the direction where of the steepest ascent, okay, I said that is going to give you the direction of the gradient. And how to find out the magnitude of the gradient? That is measured by the slope in that direction. Now here, what is our function? Here the function we are talking about is the height of the hill. Okay, the height of the hill. Okay, here the function we are talking about is the height of the hill, and the coordinate it depends are the depends on our positions, latitude and longitude. See, okay, so that is going to give you the thing. And now this function, the function which I had talked about here, what is our function? The function is the height of the hill, and this function, okay, it depends on two variable. Here it is not depending upon three variable. Okay, Are you getting it? This function depends only on two variable, not three. But the geometrical meaning of the gradient is easier to grasp in two dimensions. So it is easier for us, you know, like if you talk about the, if you want to find the gradient of a function in two dimension, then the entire thing becomes much easier as compared to the previous one. Okay, so this is what is the gradient of a scalar function. Okay, now next what we want to talk about is the divergence of a vector. Now, as I've already mentioned it to you, that whenever we are taking the gradient, now this question may come for MCQ as well, huh? For your exam, for your university exam, the question may come like this, that the gradient of a scalar function is dash. So you'll have to know that whenever we are operating delta on any scalar function, we are getting a scalar or a vector. So whenever we are operating gradient on a scalar function, okay, or the delta on a scalar function, we are going to get a vector quantity. Okay, so this is what you'll have to keep in mind. Okay, I hope this is clear to you, what is the meaning of the gradient of a function, because it is one of the most important topic, whether you are talking about your semester course or you are talking about higher studies and all, where you are going to opt for different entrance exams. You'll find that there will be a question definitely from the gradient of a vector. And in my upcoming slides, okay, in my next lectures, which I'm going to give you, I'm going to discuss about the numerical part of the gradient. We are going to solve some numericals, okay, on gradient and all. Okay. Now, the next topic which I'm going to discuss is the divergence. Okay. Now, from the definition of delta itself, we are going to construct what is called as the divergence of a vector. Okay. From the definition of delta, we can construct the divergence. And the divergence of a vector is given by delta dot v. Now here, most important thing you have to keep it in mind is that I'm giving here a symbol dot. Okay, if you simply write this nabla without any dot and operate it on any scalar function, then we will call it as gradient. But when I am writing this delta together with this symbol dot, meanings changes. Okay, what does it mean? It means that we are talking about another part of differential calculus, that is the divergence of the vector. So delta dot v. Now don't get confused, here I have written v, I'm not talking about potential. Okay, here I'm saying that this v is a v is a vector. Okay, here the v which I have taken, that is a vector quantity. Okay, it is not potential. Okay, so divergence of v, so this delta can be written as what? I car del del x plus j car del del y plus k car del del z dot vxi plus vyj plus vzk. Okay, so if you do the dot product, what you are going to get, you are going to get del vx del x plus del vy del y plus del vz del z. Now here in this equation, if you see, we don't have any direction associated with it. That means what? If you have no direction associated, it is only depending upon these variables. No direction is associated with it. That means it is giving me a scalar quantity. So that is the reason I wrote the divergence of a vector is a scalar quantity. Always keep this in mind. These are going to come in the examination as an MCQ. They may frame this question as an MCQ. Okay. The divergence of a vector is a scalar quantity. Okay. Now, question arises, what is the geometrical interpretation? Like as I had discussed in my previous class, the geometrical interpretation of divergence. Same way, I'm going to talk geometrical interpretation of gradient. I'll talk here about the geometrical interpretation of divergence as well. So, divergence of V gives you what? It's a measure of how much your vector v, okay, spreads out from the point in question. I'm considering a point, and from that point, how much my vector is spreading out, okay, that measurement will give me the divergence of a vector. Okay, now for example, if you talk about, I'll show you in my slides, I have drawn these three different diagrams. Okay. Now, in first case, this is the point, things are moving out. Okay, the vectors are moving out. Okay, the arrows are pointed pointed in the outward direction. That means here the function is having a large positive divergence. Okay, but if the arrows are pointing inward, no, if this would have pointed in the inward direction, I will say that it is having a large negative divergence. Okay, clear to you? Now, if you talk about this particular thing, 1b, okay, here the function has zero divergence. Okay, here the function is having a zero divergence. Why it is having a zero divergence? Because if you see the direction, this is not spreading out. These vectors are arranged in a haphazard manner. So what will I say? That here the value of here the divergence is zero. But when we talk about the third figure, which I have shown you, here what you find that, you know, these vectors are spreading. Okay, these vectors are spreading in the outward direction. So here what we'll say that here once again we'll have that these are having a positive divergence. Okay, so what happened is this. In the diagram, of course, okay, I can only draw the arrows at a few representative locations. Okay, suppose you say, for example, if you want to explain it, suppose you would say that you are standing on the edge of a pond. Okay, then what do? You sprinkle some sawdust or pine needles on the surface of it. If the material is spread out, okay, then you drop it at a point of positive divergence. If it collect together, you drop it at a point of negative divergence. Okay, so always remember this. You are standing on the side of a pond, and suppose sometimes it happens. So if you throw a pebble on the pond, then what happens? The water spreads out. That means it is diverging. The function, what is happening? It is spreading out. But if it contracts, if it shrinks, then it is having negative divergence. Okay. So I hope that this much is clear to all of you. In my upcoming lecture, I'll come up with the curl of a vector, and after that, I'm going to discuss the numericals based on that, so that things will become more clear. Thank you.